Much is made of the fundamental antagonism between American political parties, but it mostly results from strategies of brand differentiation. Modern, large-scale, technological, bureaucratic state capitalism has produced a modern form of feudalism, with a permanently indebted army of peasant labor. Cynics, such as Eric Etheridge in the New York Times, claim that this trend is just fine because access is better than ownership. But their Keynesian rat race is exactly the problem. You only have access as long as you can keep making the payments. Keynesian liberals have encouraged a borrow-and-spend economy that drains household wealth, leaving none for savings and investment. The effect has been to accelerate the transfer of income from spenders to savers, which is functionally the same as transferring income from the poor to the rich. Keynesianism reverses Robin Hood because the wealthy have mostly investment wealth and consume very small amounts of their income. Sure, it's great to have mere access to a library of television shows and songs, but what about the land you inhabit or your house or your car? How great is it to not own your own stocks or business? Alain de Botton, in his book Status Anxiety, wrote, "In the United States in 1907, a book entitled 3 Acres and Liberty seized the imagination of the reading public." The author, Bolton Hall, began by taking for granted the awkwardness of having to work for someone else, and so told readers that they could regain their freedom by leaving their offices and factories and buying 3 acres of farmland in Middle America at a reasonable cost. If the message grew more frequent from this period onwards, it was because for the first time a majority of people were ceasing to work on their own farms or in small family businesses and were starting to sell their intelligence and their strength in return for a wage given to them by someone else. In 1800, 20% of the American workforce was employed by another person. By 1900, the figure was 50%, by 2000, 90%. Employers were also taking on more people. In 1800, less than 1% of the American workforce was employed in an organization with 500 or more employees. By 2000, the figure was 55%. Joel Kotkin, in his book Neo-Feudalism, writes, "In the United States, the proportion of land owned by the 100 largest private landowners grew by nearly 50% between 2007 and 2017, according to the Land Report. In 2007, this group owned a total of 27 million acres of land equivalent to the area of Maine and New Hampshire combined. A decade later, the 100 largest landowners held 40.2 million acres, more than the entire area of New England. In much of the American West, billionaires have created vast estates that many fear will make the rest of the local population land poor. Land ownership in Europe too is becoming more concentrated in fewer hands. In Great Britain, where land prices have risen dramatically over the past decade, less than 1% of the population owns half of all the land. On the continent, farmland is being consolidated into larger holdings, while urban real estate has been falling into the hands of a small number of corporate owners and the mega-wealthy." According to PolitiFact, despite the fact that almost half of all households own stock shares either directly or indirectly through mutual funds, trusts, or various pension accounts, the richest 10% of households controlled 84% of the total value of these stocks in 2016. The present level of home ownership is back to where it was in 1980, and Americans are in more debt than ever. Total household debt rose by $206 billion to $14.56 trillion in the fourth quarter of 2020. The pre-recession peak of $12.7 trillion was reached in 2008. There seems to be a strange convergence of views, on the far left and libertarian right, about various guaranteed income and negative income tax proposals, and for good reason. Disregarding the periods of extreme irrationality and inefficiency found in markets, the left has slowly admitted to the productivity of modern capitalism versus nationalization. What they have very slowly come to understand is that those in lower income brackets lack consumer power, not government monopoly services and their attendant bullshit job bureaucracies and waste spending. On the other hand, the right has slowly come to accept the fact that a global, technological capitalist society produces a winner-takes-all economy where fewer and fewer workers are needed to sustain production. In other words, capitalism is increasingly cannibalizing itself by starving itself of demand. It turns out that there was never really a fundamental incompatibility between market economies and syndicalist goals. Capitalism can deliver its competitive efficiencies at the same time its workers can own large stakes in the means of production. It's really a marriage made in heaven, but Keynesianism has prevented the working class from building savings and ownership to share in the profits of firms. If we are to save ourselves from a slaving feudalism, we need to make ownership more widespread and not less.